Namaskaram. We are happy to bring to you the second episode of Explore with Ritvik and I. In these episodes, we'll be exploring the less commonly known musical aspects of stalwarts that we have all been listening to since a young age. This episode, we'll be bringing to you the music of Sri G.N. Balasubramanyam. And I'd like to start with a small story as to how I started listening to G.N. sir. It was, I think, 1999 or 2000, and after watching a movie, my dad and I, he took me to this store in Bombay called Planet M in South Mumbai, and we're looking for music CDs because that was our source of music at that point in time over there. So we were looking at CDs to buy, and there was a small section of Carnatic music that was there in Planet M also. My father picked up this, there was a cassette, there was not a CD of G.N. Balasubramanyam sir at that point. He picked up a cassette of G.N. Balasubramanyam sir and said that, you know, he was trying to build this collection of musicians that I could listen to also. He already had old recordings that he had recorded of stalwarts like Chembavidnath Bhagavathar, M.D. Ramanathan, Sir Madhuramani, and, you know, many musicians. So G.N. Balasubramanyam was, I think, missing from that. And as soon as he saw it, he picked it up. And I remember listening to that cassette, and one song that really stuck with me that I listened to a lot in that cassette was Paraloka Sadhaname Manasa in Purvi Kalyani. And the flamboyance of his music, the speed at which he sang, the Nerabal Swaram, the clarity of Brika, which actually he is known for. So that really, I really took to that sound and that music, and it fascinated me, and that's how I got hooked on to his music. And, you know, big fan of him also. So let's look at the different aspects of G.N. Balasubramanyam sir's music and delve deeper into it. Like I said before, what really appealed to me the moment I heard him for the first time was his flamboyance in music, his brika-laden music, his general pace of the music, which was, right now, after listening to so many other stalwarts of that time, it seems to be a little faster than what was the pace of music at that point in time. So, and it was really refreshing to see somebody singing music at that pace with so many brika sangatis, which was also balanced by so many karveis and, you know, short phrases. So it was very refreshing. It was very new to me, that kind of music, that kind of presentation, that sound of music itself.
Yeah, absolutely. I also think that when we speak about GNB, more often than not, the focus goes on the brika because it's extremely captivating to the listener. It's extremely fascinating that somebody could sing like that, because before him, nobody, I think, exploited that facet of the voice. The speed of the music was generally faster before his time. The compositions were all sung much faster. That we see even in some contemporaries of his, and even musicians after him, where the speed of their Nerval Swaram Kirtana singing is fast. But for somebody to use the voice in that manner to bring out the nuance of a raga in a very new manner that wasn't heard before was, I think, phenomenal for people to listen to then and for all of us to still listen to now. So having said that, it's very, I think, also easy for people to box him into that category where all of the other facets of his music is not seen as much. The fact that the brigas were so well positioned between all of his other aspects of music is what I think highlights
the brika also,
that particular character, because of which it gets prominence, because of which he also knew how much of it to use, where to use it, and how to use it.
Another thing about G.N. sir is that he is also one of the few musicians who successfully created his own bani. Even though predominantly he was self-taught, there was a certain discipline in the way he sang, in the Patantara that he sang for Kirtanams, in the way he approached Manodharma, in the way he approached the sound of Carnatic music itself, which kind of created a style of singing which he could successfully pass on to his students and his students to their students after that, and it became a way of singing, a certain bani, if you can say so.
Absolutely. I mean, for a style to become a bani, there have to be certain markers where people from across banis can take qualities from, say, a bani that is not theirs but still imbibe it into their own style, where it still sounds like theirs. That is extremely important for a bani to be wholesome, that people across styles can pick up from it and make it their own. And that is something that we see, because now in Carnatic music, most of the brigas we hear, or most of the faster phrases we hear, are all in some way a reflection of what he did, especially in ragas like, say, Sahara or Begada. Most of the fast phrases revolve around a phrase that he probably sang, which we are developing on right now in multiple different ways.
Right.
And the fact that his bani used beautiful jarus that were also not that common in Carnatic music at that point. If you listen to Saveri, he'll be singing a fast phrase and he'll land on a sa and then bring it down all the way till the re below.
Right.
And those were very unnatural jarus in the way we listen to music at that point among his contemporaries, but then they sound so beautiful when it is placed within the context of how the jaru is used and what it links to the next phrase. So there were many stylistic aspects of his that he consciously put into his music that really add a very different character and make it stand out from any other bani, which is why it has its own separate body of work.
Like you said, his bani was kind of very easily incorporated into people who sang, artists who sang in other styles also. One example that comes to mind very starkly is Ramnath Krishnan sir's music. It was a beautiful amalgamation of his own style, and he was also very... it was known that he was influenced by Jain Balasubramaniam sir's music, and that speaks of a bani actually.
Absolutely. It's interesting that that happened, because it's also no secret that JNB as a musician also took a lot from Nariyakudi Ramanujangar. If you look at his concert lists throughout, of every concert that we have, you will see him start religiously almost every concert with Avaram, followed by a Hamsadhwani song on Ganesha, followed by maybe a raga like Puri Kalyani or Panturali, which was extremely close to the Kacheri Paddhati that was set by Nariyakudi Ramanujangar. And we've heard so many musicians say that JNB idolized him. So it's phenomenal that you take a structure from one person, you take different aspects of music from what you've listened, and then you use your intellect to put that together to suit your idea of what music is, that then other people can take from and you can pass it on from.
That's the brilliance of that bani. And actually, there is a nice photo of Arigudi Ramanujayengar's Kacheri, on which you can see Jain sir sitting on the stage on the
sitting
side.
And almost peeping into the concert frame like that. I mean, it also shows that musicians were also very open to acknowledge their source in those days.
Right.
Where the compositions that he sang, which weren't in vogue in the concert platform at that point, even if it were in familiar ragams like Hamsadhwani and Panturali, he found his own compositions like Vinayaka or Gam Ganapate, or even say in Panturali Sundara Deham, which musicians did not sing at that point. But that does not mean that he did not sing compositions like Ma Janaki or Sri Subramanyaya Namaste or Sarasa Samadana, which were also attributed to his contemporaries. But he still sang those compositions and gave it his own flavor, his own twist, with his own thinking and interpretation of that particular composition. Which means that inspiration can be taken in multiple ways. You can take inspiration from the structure that Ariyakudi has said, but then what can you do with that structure? What can you do in terms of the kind of ragams you use, the kind of compositions you sing, the pace of the compositions between that structure? Similarly, what can you do with the compositions that somebody else has popularized? Can you give it your own twist? If you really enjoy singing that composition, do you still need to stick to what people are used to, or can you do something that you really enjoy or you see as a pivotal melodic point in that composition? And that's something that he did a lot. We'll look at a few of those examples
Just like Panturali and Hamsadhwani, like you mentioned, we have examples in Puri Kalani, Paraloka Sadhaname. You have examples in Todi, where he sang Chesina Della, Arakimpave, Anandana Desha. So Yeah, it was another composition that I heard in one of those cassettes that I bought before. So, Ananda Natesha in Todi. And you also see, like, for example, if you take J. Sinadella, there is a Sangati progression that happens. He sang Kitrams like Dharni Telusukundini with Sangati progressions that were perfectly fixed. So, if you look at his recordings of Kirtanams across concerts, you will actually see that the Sangati progression is maintained, the Patantara is maintained, the discipline is maintained. So I think that's also another important point to be observed when you actually see a Bani being created, right? And something that has to be passed on to people, that to students and to other artists, there is one discipline that is maintained.
Absolutely.
And I think that's very important.
Definitely. It's important that it's not fluid.
Right.
Even, let's say, the pace at which we sing a certain composition is maintained for that particular Bani, because the Sangatis are also structured in a way by which it suits a particular pace.
Right.
So the moment you drop the pace or increase the pace, then that shift needs to happen, which is something that we need to also, I think keep
about.
In mind.
Yeah, of course. And there were also, so these are the major Kirtanams like Dharni Telusukontini Tesinadella that he sang. There are also Kirtanams like Himagiri Tanaye, Kirtanams like Kannanayan Kanavan, Kirtanams like
Sudhamayi,
so many.
Mamavatu Shri Saraswati. Many of these compositions that are again very short, maybe 3-4 minute compositions that you didn't hear most of his other contemporary singing. You heard only in his concerts. So what his source was for most of these compositions, where he got them from, how his thought process was in choosing which to incorporate into the into his concert music was, I think, very interesting thing by itself to look at.
And Senju Kamboji, and he sang them with the same kind of discipline and
integrity
in all his concerts. And if you listen to those compositions across recordings also, they will sound the same.
Yeah, and it's very rare that so many of these kind of compositions immediately kind of invoke the memory of a musician, like say Sevika Vendumaya. The fact that one musician even now in a concert, if somebody sang any of these songs, anybody who's listened to, say, GNB would immediately identify with him, which shows the impact that he created by singing even the smaller compositions and the importance he gave them.
Right, of course.
Varugelara, oh Raghava, Varugelara, oh Raghava.
apart from this, it's also interesting that he also presented a lot of Muthuswami Dikshitar compositions. Shri Subramanyaya Namaste, though, was first popularized by Ariyakudi, many musicians later have performed the composition, and GNB especially has given it his own twist, where you will find him singing Swaram and Niraval in lines that weren't explored before. It wasn't always at Vasavadi, it was at Tapatraya, or it was at Bhusuradi, in different lines, which then I think gives us as listeners an entirely different picture of what is possible in exploring that particular composition. Mm-hmm. And having said that, his exploration of Karikalabamukham is also very famous, where you will find him singing swarams for Karikalabamukham, where the takeoff point is on the Tarasthai Gandharam for a ragam like Saveri. Sometimes you will see him sing Neraval and Swaram at Harihayadi. So
that Jaru that you spoke about actually comes in that recording.
Yeah, and I mean, and it's a phenomenal that the point where the line begins is oftentimes for somebody like GNB not of great consideration when he's singing Neraval of Swaram.
Hmm.
Where he goes more with the flow of the ragam, where for a takeoff point like Hari, which is in the Adhara Shajja, you will find him at the Da or the Sa on top and then link
coming
back
from there
to that when he's singing Neraval or Swaram, which is very intriguing in how he visualized finishing points, which we obsess about, where
right.
where we say if it's on Pa, you finish on Ma or Da. None of that was in consideration as long as it sounded like that ragam, which I think
right.
is important. And of course, he also sang other Dikshitar compositions like Ramachandram Bhavayami,
mm-hmm.
which is again something that he's very popularly known for. Having said that, there are many examples of him retaining aspects of what he's learnt in the way he performs a composition. For example, there's a wonderful recording of E. Vasudha, where throughout the composition, you will find him singing the Sadharana Gandhara in Sahana,
mm-hmm.
which
right.
we today attribute to the Dikshitar style of Sahana in,
right.
say, Sri Kamalambikaya or
Ishanadi.
But the fact that he sang Eva Sudha like that, in fact, even when he sings the Chittaswaram,
right.
you will find him using the Pamagamari sections with the smaller ga, where then it shows that for a musician like him, who was considered very intellectual, who was considered very grammatically right, to retain this shows that he had a wonderful balance between what he thought was right grammatically, but also what he thought was tradition and what was important to retain. He did not change something because that
didn't
contradicts
fit the grammar.
His idea of what grammar is. The beautiful facet about a musician like GNB, who is considered an intellectual, is that the intellect comes together with both the grammar and the melody and the practice. You can't separate the three. And this composition, just the rendering of this composition, is a wonderful example of that. And the way he and the alav or the proportion, as we say, of that Gandharam in the way he sings it is beautiful, and especially at the speed at which he sings. Let's listen to that.
Yeah, let's listen to that.
వసుధాని వంటి దేవము 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 వసుధాని వంటి దేవము
So you also see that he takes up ragas like Sahana, Anand Bhairavi, Athana, Deva Manohari for exposition in Ragam Tanam Pallavis. There are beautiful recordings of him singing Athana, Ragam Tanam Pallavi or Anand Bhairavi, Deva Manohari. Todi, apart from the ragas like Todi, Kamboji, his Tille Isane Kana's famous Pallavi that he sang, and everybody has, I'm sure, has heard that recording. And so yes,
same
he's
with,
taken up those ragas.
Todi, I mean, but then the wonderful difference between handling those ragams when you listen to his recordings is that he never sang a 40 minute Anand Bhairavi raga. He
right.
knew that the proportion of Anand Bhairavi for his expansion and exploration was still somewhere between 15 and 20 minutes. But then when you listen to Shanmugapriya Ragam Tanam Pallavi or ragas like Todi, Kalyani, Kamboji that he sang so much of, you will find the step by step raga progression that we see in olden day texts on how you're supposed to sing, where first you sing a flash for about 2 minutes, then you explore it portion by portion, and then you wind down. That you will, there are ample recordings of him singing 45 minute alapanas, 50 minute alapanas, of just expanding ragas like that. So that's also very important for us to understand that he never expanded an athana for 50 minutes. Not that it can't be done, but then whether it needs to be done is a question that I think
right.
we need to
that
ask.
Of,
and that was very clear in his presentation. That was not something that he ever took for granted.
Yeah, for example, I mean, it's like a textbook for singing ragam in Deva Manohari or Alapana in Deva Manohari. You look at it, he sung a considerable chunk of Deva Manohari for a considerable amount of time. But like you said, the approach is not like you settle at a swaram and, you know, then build it and then come and go step by step.
Yeah.
But then there is a certain thought process and a certain progression also in the way he has approached Deva Manohari or Athana or even Natakunji. There is a beautiful recording of him singing Natakunji for a Pallavi. There is a like slight progression in the way he approaches the different regions of the ragas with the different sounds, with the different gamakas, and interspersed with his famous brikas also.
Yeah.
So.
Which is also, I think, indicative of how he looked at raga.
Right.
Because when we look at his exploration of, say, Kalyani or Todi, those are ragas that yield for exploration where you can pick on one note, expand around one note, take your time and then move on to the note. For example, if you take Todi, you can literally expand on Sa, Ga, Ma, Pa, on all of these notes.
Right.
And he would spend time on all of these notes, and he would even find phrases where the Re would be explored in multiple different ways. But in a raga like Deva Manohari, there is no one swaram that you can use as an anchor point and then build around. So which means that he let the sound of the ragam and the flow of the ragam determine the kind of ragam that he sang. He may still have sung a good 10 to 15 minutes, but it was still with the notion of understanding that Deva Manohari as a ragam needs to be expanded in a certain way where the movement was fluid and not fixed, where you started at one point, you went up and then you came down.
Right.
There are ragas like that where he starts just on top because he realizes that that's where the impact of the ragam is, and then winds down and then finishes the ragam quickly. So it was very, determined by the feel and the melody of what that raga gave him, as opposed to what he wanted to do with the scale of that ragam, which I think is very important because as much as we say he sang a lot of scalar ragams, how he treated those scalar ragams is important for us to look at, because he did not treat them as just scales.
Mentioned he has different approaches for singing alapanas in different ragas. He also took up ragas like Malay Marutam, Jayamanohari, Senchukamboji, Kiranavali, Malavi for not only alapanas but also for Nerval Swaram. And let's go step by step. So if you look at his alapana, you'll see him developing phrase by phrase. Not only in these ragams, if you look at ragams like Begada Kamboji also, there are parts of the ragam in his expansive development where he takes phrases of the ragams and he develops on the phrases of the ragams. For example, if you take a small phrase, he'll make a small development on that phrase. Then there is a small development over that development, which kind of builds into this whole body of sound around that phrase, and it gives a completely different picture of the raga. And he kind of uses this approach for the so-called rarer ragas or smaller scalar based ragas like a Malavi or a Senchukamboji or a Kiranavali. And it's just brilliant the way he moves through the raga and, you know, the way the raga flows for him. And this approach, he uses it for alapanas. You can see the way he sings Nerval also. There is a beautiful clarity in the way he looks at the raga. He is aware of the scale, but he is also aware of the phraseology of the raga and the way he can use it. It's brilliant. Like, for example, when you know there's a raga with Padasa and Sanidapa, he's aware that you can use a Padanidapa over there, and he uses it in raga alapana, in swaram singing, in Nerval.
That approach is also visible when you see how crisp it is. More often than not, when the clarity of what the ragam is not there in our mind as a musician, more often than not, you will find that there will be a meandering of what is possible and a lack of clarity. But then when he sings Nerval for, say, songs like Nenarum Chinanu or Vararagalaya or Sarasa Samadana even, you will find that even if he sings only three or four Nervals, they're extremely to the point, crisp, but complete in what he covers in those three or four rounds.
Right.
Which is possible only when you have a comprehensive and a complete understanding of the sound of that raga.
Of course, of course. You can also look at the way he sings swarams for, there's a beautiful recording where he sings swarams for Sarasa Samadana. We are so accustomed to hearing swarams at Hito Matalintu.
Yeah.
But if you listen to that recording, the first swaram that you would have sung is Pamagariga Sarasa Samadana.
Which is very unnatural to what we are used to hearing, but so beautiful at the same time because it's such a different perspective of what is possible in Kapi Narayani, because it changes the entire color.
Sound of Kapi Narayani. He in the middle of the recording, he changes it also, right? He goes to Nidapada Sarasasa. The way he starts Sarasa Samadana, is like you said before, it's not adhering to that principle of the line starts in this swaram, so you start in the next swaram, you end the swaram in the previous swaram or the one before that. But he takes that liberty because he is so clear about the sound of the ragam, that he can end the swaram wherever he want and come back to the pallavi, starting the pallavi at a different point also, flowing into the structure of the pallavi. Sarasavadana starts at the sajjam, but then he is ending the swaram at da and starting Sarasavadana with a flourish coming back to the structure of Sarasavadana. That's a very beautiful aspect of his music.
Yeah, which shows that he is not somebody who is driven by the scale only. For example, even if you look at say his exploration of Neraval in Malavi, when you look at how he uses the charanam line, the first line in Kalilo, he uses the syllable of what the words represent in a very interesting way to bring about a different sound of the turn of the raga.
Right.
Because more often than not for Malavi, the nipa mada mani, when you look at that, you will never hear the ni da in Malavi. Because you're so conscious that when you go to ni, you have to come back to pa.
Right.
But knowing that the spacing of Kalilo gives you that freedom, I remember the first Neraval he sings is Kalilo ma, which is not wrong because the ni da, from the you're still going up.
Yeah.
And then when you want to go past the, then you sing nipa. But when you look at that as a phrase by itself, that gives you an opening into the usage of a phrase like dani da nipa that you will never get if you look at just the aronam aronam of a scale.
Right, of course.
Which means that it's so instinctive, it's also driven by what is possible when you add syllables over melody.
Kalilo matamune tukone kan saranu sanayu labro tuta kai kalilo.
When you then revisit the ragalapana that he sang, that Danida Nipa is never there in the alapana. But that is something that he found only when he sang Neraval. So which means that the different facets of Manodharma also give rise to different expressions of the ragam based on what that form of Manodharma provides as a canvas. So I think that is wonderful to look at in ragams like this, that he's explored not just for one aspect of Manodharma, but where you will find him singing Alapana, Neraval
and Swaram. Right. It opens up a complete new sound of that raga for us as listeners, also as students of music. So.
Absolutely, because if not for him, then how we would approach Malavi as a ragam for us to sing Raga Alapana might be entirely different. But given that he's given us a canvas or a picture to start with, it makes our basic job much easier. It's like just how we listen to 100 explorations of Todi because of which it becomes familiar.
Right.
This one gives us the picture of what we can do for a ragam like this. So
right,
I think these kind of explorations by musicians like him are equally important in giving us a very different window into ragams like this.
Right. Also, there is a beautiful recording of Kiranavali which he has sung ragam for, Alapana for.
Yeah, and at least in Malavi, because of the turn and because of the fact that you jump swarams, there is some amount of abstraction which is possible.
Right.
But in Ragam Kiranavali, which is basically Sarigama Padanisa Kiravani Sa Pa Magarisa.
That's all.
That's so tricky to first sing, to execute vocally, because of how tricky that Sa Pa is. Because each time you go up or you want to come back down,
you have to come from Sa
Pa. Gari Sa Pa is such a tricky thing, which then also means that you have to sing it only at a certain pace for
right.
that to be able to deliver musically.
Right.
Which means you can't slow it down to the speed of a Devagandhari or a Neelambari and recreate that effect to the same impact of what is possible if you were to sing it in a Madhyama Kalam, which
right.
is what that song and the Ragam constantly kind of yields to, which means that then the approach has to be entirely different on how you can handle the Sapa.
Right, of course. Also, Kiranavali as a ragam is quite close to Kiravani, and he beautifully shows a difference in sound of the raga, pace of the raga, the way he approaches it. He's also taken up so many ragams like Manirangu. He's taken up Andolika. Today, you associate the ragam Andolika with GN sir, Ragasudhara sir, the way he approaches swaram singing in that Kirtanam, the way he approaches singing Alapana for that. So when you look at him singing Madhyamavati, Manirangu and Andolika, there is a stark difference in the way he approaches the raga itself, like you said.
Yeah.
It's very beautiful. So
when you talk about Kiranavali, actually one other thing that just struck me was when he also sings phrases like Padanisapa, he uses also the jantai very beautifully to lean on or kind of anchor the return point.
Right, right.
Rigama padani sari sasa pa. So you hear a hint of the knee that offers a different anchor point as opposed to hearing just the risa pa every time. Risa sa pa is a very different texture to the ear as opposed to risa pa, which he uses beautifully there. That's something that.
So when you look at his phrase-based development of ragams and the way he starts ragams and approaches it differently, there's a beautiful recording of Athana where he starts with a very, very unusual phrase. If I remember right, he starts the ragam with with that phrase. It's a very unusual start and it immediately opens up a different canvas of Athana for you. There is also beautiful recording, I think 1964 Music Academy recording of Kalyami Raghuramam in Begra, where he sang Alapna for Begra. You can actually see and hear this phrase-based development that he does. And it opens up a different color of Begra. It gives you such new phrases. Today, the phrase that we sing, he has used that phrase, developed it, built it in context, and let's listen to these examples now.
I
saranan 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 da 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 na 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 sa ra 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 sa ra 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 na 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 na
So apart from ragas like Kamboji, Todi, as opposed to Begada, Sahana, even ragas like Atana, Ahiri, or ragas like Jayantashri, and Andolika, and all of these ragams, which are of course phrase-based, scale-based, a lot of these different types, he is also someone who was extremely open to the idea of singing Vivadi Swara Ragas, which not many of his contemporaries did. There are examples of him singing Vivadi Swara Ragas, especially ragas like Chandra Jyoti. And we actually see a major expansion of these kind of ragas from his disciples, like say M.L. Vasanta Kumari or S. Kalyan Raman, who really embraced ragas like this and gave them a wonderful different canvas. So also a testament to his vision of music, which you then see come across in the way he composed songs and also the kind of ragas he chose for composing. Mm-hmm. But before we go to that, let's next go to the Thanam, where you know, if we have to look at his Thanam singing, it was very different from what we generally identify as Thanam singing. We say that there should be a continuous flow without any breaks, and there should be permutations and combinations and patterns that keep developing. But interestingly, in his Thanams, you will find that it is more just a flow of different phrases of the ragam that he puts together with a meter, that he finishes with a flourish of phrase that doesn't have a meter and then has pauses in between. So his Thanam, each section of Thanam that he sings before he hands it over to the violinist, for example, will have multiple gaps in between that has phrases or ends with a note that has a gamaka, or he maybe chooses one swaram that he keeps landing back on. So that's a very different approach to Thanam singing as opposed to what we are told Thanam should sound like. If we also see his approach towards, let's say, different types of ragams, this approach was still constant in the way he sang Thanam between, say, a Bhairavi or a Todi or a Kalyani, two ragas like Ananda Bhairavi, Nata Kurunji, Deva Manohari, etc. So, which means that his concept of how a Thanam should be sung was constant across the different types of ragams. So the type of the ragam did not determine the flow or the pattern with which he sang, but more the idea of that form of Manodharma itself.
Right. I don't know.
Even if you look at the choice of his pallavis, most of them were in Aditalam and had a natural flow and propensity towards Neraval singing. You look at his pallavi Tillai Isanekana in Kamboji, his Nate Gurunji pallavi, the pallavi in Devamanohari, the pallavi in Todi. All these pallavis lend themselves to explore the raga in different ways through Neraval, rather than, you know, just singing the pallavis for mathematical calculation sake. And he beautifully explored different Aditala pallavis in one raga differently, showing different colors of the raga also.
Pillai Kishana Kalayanda Punniyam Seidhalo Pillai Kishana Kalayanda Punniyam Seidhalo Pillai Kishana Kalayanda Punniyam Seidhalo Pillai Kishana Kalayanda
When you look at his choice of line for Neraval singing in Kirtrams also, if you take Nithithala Sukama for example, he chooses the line Sumati Tyagaraja, which starts at Tarastha Irshabam and it starts 10 aksharams after the samam in Mishra Chaputala. So it's a very different picture of Kalyani, starting at that point of the raga in the melody and that point in the talam, and the structure of the line also, it gives you a different picture of Kalyani when he explores Neraval in that line. So similarly, he chooses different yadams for singing swaram also in Kirtrams.
Yeah, for example, when we look at Sri Subramanyaya Namaste, of course, like we spoke about, apart from singing Neravals at different points in different concerts, he also sings swarams in three different places. Hmm. At Bhusuradi, at Vasavadi, and at Taraka. So he flips between the three, he alternates between the three. And one very interesting aspect of his swaram singing that I think has led to a phenomenon today that we call Purutam singing was, I think the seed for that was from his exploration of swaram singing, where it wasn't a direct Purutam to the entire line or the word itself, mm-hmm. like how we understand Purutam today, but then he would pick different landing points where the landing point would yield into a takeoff point of that particular line which sounded like a Purutam. And I think musicians who played along with him, like Lalgudi Jayaraman for example, expanded on that idea of what a Purutam is, and multiple musicians have picked up on that idea and used it in their music and given us multiple interpretations of that. But I think the idea of what a Purutam can be in a very abstract way in Carnatic music was first explored by G.N. Balasubramanian.
Of course.
One of the other important facets of his music is his rhythm and shlokam singing. Musicians of his generation like Shemmangudi, Madhuramani Iyer, along with GNB, really revolutionized this aspect of music and brought it into mainstream concert music. You find that in a lot of films before that. In fact, there's a very famous recording of him singing that beautiful Kamboji shlokam in a movie. But to bring that into mainstream concert music where the emotion of the lyrics is carried forward by apt choices of ragam and using appropriate ragams to expand on the emotional quotient of the lyrics was done beautifully by Shri GNB. And there are many beautiful examples of him singing shlokams. There's one particular example where he starts with Sahana, moves on to Begada. That's a beautiful shlokam. So we will just listen to that.
Marudalam mahayata varvaal vanaminni marundi kanam tariye ye 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 Mayangina Vindaye 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 Nan Mayangina Vindaye
But it's important to understand that these were different things that were evolving and being added into the concert structure that we celebrate today, but has inputs from musicians who've all practiced it for the last 75 to 100 years.
Yeah, of course, of course. He's also taken up ragams like Ahiri for exposition in Virthams, and he's actually, there is a ragam, I've also heard that along with, he was very close to Bade Gulam Ali Khan Sahib in Hindustani music, and along with him, the two of them came up with a ragam called Gavati. And there is a beautiful virtam, a shlokam that he has sung in the ragam Gavati. We can listen to that also. So until now, we've seen GN sir as a musician. He was also a prolific composer. He composed various kirtanams and varnams in different languages like Sanskrit, Tamil and Telugu. And he also used different ragas for composing his compositions. For example, there is a varnam in Andolika. Well, there is also a varnam in Yadukula Kamboji, a Natatala varnam in Yadukula Kamboji. There are kirtanams in ragas like Amrita Behag that I think he is the only one who's composed in this raga. There are compositions in
Yadukula Kamboji again.
Yes, Yadukula Kamboji again, of course. And in Saraswati, in Hamsanandi,
Nalina Kanti.
There are all these beautiful compositions in different languages, and Arabhi also. There is a beautiful composition, Maravanane, in Arabhi.
Parame Sari Paramatriba Tagari Pagi Parame Sari Paramatriba Tagari Papa Naba Todari
பசி பிரியவரம் கரி பத்மநாப சோதரி பசி பிரியவரம் கரி பத்மநாப சோதரி பசி பிரியவரம் கரி சரதீஜ பவகரி பவகரி சரனு கேபுஜரி சரதீஜ பவகரி சரனு கேபுஜ சரி பரமரி சகலவேரகவதாரே சாகுபிதயவிதாரே சகலவேரகவதாரே
One great facet about his compositions, apart from the fact that they were musically rich, is also the fact that they are also lyrically rich. It's not often that we find a contemporary musician who had mastery over both melody and lyric. And when you look at his compositions and even his varnams, you can see that both go hand in hand and both gel well together so seamlessly. And the fact that he had mastery over three different languages, to be able to write songs in them and to be able to put them to tune, is phenomenal. And the fact that he was also such a magnanimous composer, and the fact that he never had his own mudra in the composition, or the fact that he never sang them himself, is, I think, testament to the creative process itself, where it was not something that he did to, I think, showcase his prowess, but more something that was created out of a deep sense of creative urge, which I think is important. And I've heard his students also say that he was very steadfast about the fact that he won't sing his compositions, and the fact that if it actually had any value in them, that they would become popular on their own. So to see somebody invest so much time and effort into a creative journey like this, but then believe in its power, I think is
a
wonderful lesson for younger musicians like us.
Also, you see his compositions, there have been inspirations from so many greats, right? We've all heard the Kannada Niranamiti Varnam, and there's a swaram that focuses on the Devatam. Similarly, if you listen to his Yadukula Kamboji Varnam, there is a swaram that focuses solely on the Devatam, and it anchors on that Devatam and finishes. So,
yeah.
You look at his Kirtanams, there are inspirations drawn from the Trinity, from various other composers,
yeah.
The way he uses the Sanskrita words, the way he uses prasam and everything. I mean, it shows that his musical acumen, his lyrical acumen, and his openness of getting inspired from various sources.
Apart from, of course, being a prolific performer and a composer, he was also a much sought-after teacher who spent a lot of time, I think, passing on his values and his music and his wealth of knowledge to a lot of students. And there are so many of them who have been their own trailblazers in the field of Carnatic music. And I also believe that it is the responsibility of every artist, musician, performer to also pass on the knowledge to the next generation, because that is the only way we maintain a continuing link between the past and the present and the future.
Of course. So
he is one of the many musicians who's also done that. And looking through all of this, it's very clear that he was a thinking musician. He was somebody who was continuously evolving. He was very open-minded. He took from where he saw good, and you can see a reflection of all of that in his music. Even when you listen to so many of his peers, so many of the elder senior musicians we've met, who have shared so many stories and incidents about him, you have a very clear picture of the mind of this person, where the kind of lifestyle he lived, the person that he was, rubbed off on everything he did, including his music. And the flamboyance with which he sang, the stylishness of who he was as a person, and just the flair that he had in life is also something that translated entirely into his music, which is also why his music is what it is.
For a generation that hasn't seen him, that hasn't met him, has only heard his music and has only heard stories of people who have met him, and these people are really, I mean, old, because he died very early in 1965. So for a generation that has only heard about him, to know about this personality, to know about how he was through his music, is something that speaks volume about how much thought that has gone into his music, how much of his personality has gone into his music, how much he lived his music.
And with that, we've come to the end of the second episode of Explore. It's been a wonderful journey for us to revisit all of the old recordings that we grew up listening to of Sriji and Balasubramaniam, and to put in words so many of the things that we've, I think, unconsciously imbibed over a period of time. And it was great for the two of us to discuss about all of that and listen to his music in such great detail again. And we look forward to bringing the next episode to you soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Kanavam,